Good evening. For our prelude this evening, we're going to play some music of Bach. I'm very glad to have Tara Harvey back with us to play. She's an oboist, a freelance player and teacher in this area, and she and her husband go to church, Storehouse Church in Plymouth Meeting. Tara has played here numerous times with our orchestra and soloist, and has taught members of our congregation this instrument. We're going to play a Bach sonata for you tonight, the whole thing, and this particular piece, like a lot of Bach's late works, is very intricate. In fact, he's exploring tonality and chromaticism and things, it seems, well beyond his time. This would have been quite progressive, shocking music in his day, in a way. And it may still be for some of you tonight, but it's very, what we call contrapuntal, it's very mathematical. There's all kinds of interesting lines woven together, and sometimes the right hand of the piano or the left hand of the piano are doing imitative things in response to the oboe or back and forth like that. So you can be listening for that kind of interplay as we play together. As with all Bach's music, this was written SDG, Soli Deo Gloria, for the glory of God. And as his children, that's how we're going to play it for you tonight.
Thank you. Good evening. I give you welcome in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ as we have gathered at this end of the day as we began, and that is to give worship to our great God. I'd like to especially welcome anyone, if you're visiting for the first time, we encourage you to fill out cards you're going to find in the pews in front of you. We encourage you to fill those out, and you can either place them in the offering plate or, even better yet, we have a little welcome center back in the narthex, some people who would love to meet you, answer any questions you may have about the church. And welcome to our pulpit this evening, Reverend Will Spokes. Reverend Spokes is a campus minister at Duke University. He's on the staff of Reformed University Ministries, which is an arm of our denomination, the Presbyterian Church in America, in which we staff campus ministries with ordained ministers, and he's been serving there, I think, about 7 years, and I'm pleased to have him here tonight. For our call to worship, let me read from Psalm 96, which is the psalm that we'll also be singing as our psalm of praise. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. We do come, our great God, gladly and willingly to give you praise and to sing of your greatness, of your glory. And we have gathered here and pray to offer unto you worship that is pleasing to you. And so we pray for that anointing, the blessing of your Holy Spirit upon us, that we in turn may be a blessing unto our God. And we give you praise that we may come before you in the name and through the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. standing and take your bulletin, and together we'll use the words to have our prayer of confession. O God, our Father, you are our Creator, and we are the work of your hands. You are our Shepherd, and we are your flock. You are our Redeemer, and we are the people you have brought back. We have sinned against you and against others. We repent of all our sins and ask for your forgiveness. We pray that you would not remain angry with us, that you would not recall our sin to punish it, but that you would continue the work you have begun in us by your Spirit, that the whole world may recognize that you are our God and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. And now hear the words of assurance given to us by God. You were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God.
Turn to the Lord in prayer. Our Father, we give you thanks for this promise to us, this assurance that we have been washed, sanctified, justified in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God, and thereby we may come before your presence. And we pray for that same Spirit who is doing that work of sanctification in us, to open our minds, to open our ears to the understanding, to hearing and understanding of your word. We pray that by your Spirit you would cause us to do that difficult work of examining our own hearts by the light of your word. And so we pray for that proclamation of your word as a means of grace that will go forth. It will be used by your Spirit to build us up, to touch our hearts, to convict us as we need conviction, to comfort those who need comforting, to strengthen all of us in our faith. May we be ever attentive to you this evening. We pray for your blessing and anointing upon our preacher this evening, that he may preach clearly your word, that it may be profitable in our own hearts. And then we pray, our Father, that we would go forth this evening strengthened and all the more determined to live by your Spirit for your glory, all the more to go forth as witnesses for our Lord Jesus Christ, and as you have made this earth to testify to your glory, so that we ourselves will be those who testify to the glory that is found in the gospel of Jesus Christ. So we lift these prayers before you in our Lord's name. Amen. For our scripture reading, for our text tonight, is Ecclesiastes chapter 11, beginning with verse 7. And if you're using the church Bibles, you'll find that on page 559. Ecclesiastes 11, verse 7 through chapter 12, verse 8. Let us hear the word of God. Light is sweet, and it is pleasant for the eyes to see the sun. So if a person lives many years, let him rejoice in them all. But let him remember that the days of darkness will be many. All that comes is vanity. Rejoice, O young man, in your youth, and let your heart cheer you in the days of your youth. Walk in the ways of your heart and the sight of your eyes. But know that for all these things, God will bring you into judgment. Remove vexation from your heart and put away pain from your body, for youth and the dawn of life are vanity. Remember also your Creator in the days of your youth, before the evil days come, and the years draw near of which you will say, I have no pleasure in them, before the sun and the light and the moon and the stars are darkened, and the clouds return after the rain, and the day when the keepers of the house tremble, and the strong men are bent, and the grinders cease because they are few, and those who look through the windows are dimmed, and the doors on the street are shut, and the sound of the grinding is low, and one rises up at the sound of a bird, and all the daughters of song are brought low. They are afraid also of what is high, and terrors are in the way. The almond tree blossoms, the grasshopper drags itself along, and desire fails, because man is going to his eternal home, and the mourners go about the streets, before the silver cord is snapped, or the golden bowl is broken, or the pitcher is shattered at the fountain, or the wheel broken at the cistern, and the dust returns to the earth as it was, and the spirit returns to God who gave it. Vanity of vanities, says the preacher, all is vanity.
dear Heavenly Father, how we rejoice to come into your presence and to have a time, a short time, of fellowship with you. We pray that indeed it will be a delight in your eyes to hear and to see all the joy that we take in you. And as part of that joy, we bring unto you our tithes and our offerings, delighted to be able to return to you a portion of what you have provided for us. We'd ask that you would use this, that many others would come to praise your name alongside of us. For it is in the precious name of Christ that we pray. Amen.
Pleasure to be here tonight, and I wanted to thank Marion and the elders here at 10th Church, as well as Liam, for the chance to be here to preach to you tonight from God's Word. And I learned this week that Liam's favorite cereal is Lucky Charms. And you should know I have four boys for whom that is their favorite cereal. And I'm sure that we will have a thank you to Liam in the mail later this week. Will be a box of Lucky Charms. But it is indeed an honor to be here tonight and to get to preach to you from this passage from Ecclesiastes. And my guess is perhaps you may be wondering, why on earth are you picking this obscure text in a book that we don't really read or talk about that much? And I suppose I could try to give you some reasons, and I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to start preaching, and my hope is and my confidence is that by the end of this, the passage will do that for us. So when we come to the book of Ecclesiastes, what we have is essentially a journey. The main character of the book is this figure who is called the preacher, and he is simply guiding us through his experiences of what he calls life under the sun. As he has navigated life, explored it, this is a book recounting what he's discovered. And my guess is if we were to sit down, or you were to sit down and you were to read this book cover to cover, it's only 12 chapters, wouldn't take you that long. My guess is you would have basically two apparently contradictory impressions. On the one hand, the majority of the book is the preacher guiding you through his experiences and his repeated efforts to outlast or to overcome the realities of life, those realities that make life so fleeting, so elusive, so apparently meaningless and frustrating and upsetting and disappointing. And time and again, we hear this refrain throughout the book. We even see it in our own passage in chapter 12, verse 8 tonight. He says, "All is vanity, a chasing after the wind." And yet, at the very same time, throughout this book, not less than six different times, we discover that there are these passages full of joy and hope and delight. And I think what you end up having is, at the very same time, the preacher is both ruthlessly honest about the brokenness of this world, the realities of life that many of you experience, and at the very same time, the possibility of joy and delight. And there is this implied question that we come to our passage tonight, which is, how are we supposed to hold those together? And my guess is, for most of us, and this would somewhat depend, I'm sure, on your temperament and your life experiences, you will probably resonate with one or the other of these impressions the book gives you. Either this very realistic, almost harsh conclusion about life under the sun, or you'll resonate with this joyful, delighted impression that you get. And I want us to think for a minute, because I think we could essentially divide this room up into two groups of people. On the one hand, we'll call the first group the hopeless pessimist. You know, you're the kind of person that no one's going to pull the wool over on your eyes. You pride yourself in calling a spade a spade. You're not afraid to say, you know, it's just not going to get better. Things are messed up. There's no hope. And you are convinced, and there's no one's going to sugarcoat it for you. However, there might be the other group, and we'll call you the naive optimist. And you're the person who's convinced it's just going to get better. It really is. And my guess is you're also the kind of person who you begin to get very uncomfortable when either your life or someone else's life close to you is not working right. You don't know what to do. Your naive optimism begins to implode, and you might find it very hard to know, how do I care about people and love them when it's not working right? So here we have the hopeless pessimist, the naive optimist. Or if you're like me, you swing wildly between the two almost every day. And what I want to do with you tonight is to look at this passage, which comes at the end of the book, towards the very end, and it's the preacher reflecting on these two basic impressions. And this question of how are we to live in light of or in view of the possibility of joy and the realities of life at the same time? Is it possible to have joy and take life seriously in all of its pain, discouragement, brokenness, and heartache? And if it is possible, what makes that possible? That's what we're going to look at tonight. And in doing that, I want to draw your attention to three things this preacher calls us to. He calls us to reevaluate, he calls us to rejoice, and he calls us to remember. So first, let's look together at this instruction to reevaluate. And in fact, what he's calling us to do here is to reevaluate your entire life. How does he make this point? Look with me here for just a moment. If you look in verse 9 of chapter 11 and verse 1, we see the word youth appear. And along with that, in chapter 12, in verses 1, 2, and 6, we see the word before appear. And in fact, that word before is very important for understanding verses 1 through 8 of chapter 12. Because he gives us a very simple command in verse 1 to remember your Creator before. 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 And what I want you to see is the preacher, in using these words of youth and before, they create together a very arresting passage. It's a blunt passage. It's a passage that has the effect of saying, stop. You need to stop. You need to reevaluate your entire life. And it might appear at first glance that the preacher's singling out young people here and basically saying, no, you young people, you're clueless. You need to wise up. Now let me help you. And I think that would be a very superficial way of reading this, because verse 8 of chapter 11 says, if a person lives many years, let him rejoice in them all. So when he comes to verse 9, it would be very odd for him to switch to just talking about young people only. Instead, what his point here is simply this: to urge every one of us to get the right foundations in place for living life as soon as possible. You are called in this passage to reevaluate your entire life. And in fact, he's trying to get you to ask the question, what are you building your life on? What are you building your life on? And that is not a trivial question for him. Throughout the book, it's a question he's wrestled with deeply. For example, listen, this is from chapter 2. This is what he discovers about all his efforts to be wise and discerning and to understand life under the sun. He says this: there is more gain in wisdom than in folly. Then I said in my heart, what happens to the fool will happen to me also. Why then have I been so very wise? You see, if there is anyone who could outrun the questions and problems of life in his own strength, he had what it would take. Throughout this book, the preacher is described as a person with unmatched financial and intellectual capacity. However, by the end of the book, he has come to realize his whole life has needed to be reevaluated. He has realized he needs an entirely new foundation upon which to root and anchor his life. And it could not be found in his intellect or his portfolio. Are you tonight building your life in some way on your intellect or your portfolio? You are meant to reevaluate that. That's what this passage is intended to get you to do. He came to see that he was building his life on the wrong things. And you need to hear me. It's not because those things were bad things. It's that he has come to realize, and we need to also, that those things were never meant to bear the weight of your trust and your hope. And he knows every one of us here is prone to do that. And you are called to reevaluate your entire life. So then what does it mean then to get the right foundations for living life? What are those? Let's keep looking. Verse 7 and 8, chapter 11. Light is sweet, and it is pleasant for the eyes to see the sun. So if a person lives many years, let him rejoice in them all. But let him remember that the days of darkness will be many. See, in these verses, he gives us two basic instructions that I want to spend the rest of our time looking at. And the two basic instructions are simply this: to rejoice and to remember. So why have I picked this passage? I find it hard to remember what I need to remember. I find it hard to rejoice. And my guess is many of you do also. And here we have a passage that is telling us your life must be built on these two things if you wish to navigate the realities of life under the sun. And it is these two basic instructions that will help us find freedom from either your hopeless pessimism or your naive optimism. Because what the preacher wants to do here, he wants to make you what we will call a joyful realist. Now, what's a joyful realist? If I could put it in one sentence, it would be this. A joyful realist is able to delight in good things without being mastered by them, and is able to face the realities of life without being undone by them. Can you delight in good things without being mastered by them? And can you face the pain and brokenness of this world without being undone by them? That's a joyful realist, and that's what this text is meant to bring about in your life. So what I want to do is look together more closely at these two basic instructions of to rejoice and to remember. So that's the second thing, is we need to learn to rejoice. Let's look here again in verse 9 and 10. The first thing that I want us to see about what does it mean to rejoice is we live before the gaze of God. Look at the end of verse 9, chapter 11. We read this: know that for all these things, God will bring you into judgment. The writer of Hebrews in the New Testament expresses the same idea when he writes this from chapter 4. He says, no creature is hidden from God's sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. But here's the question. If we do live before the gaze of God, what's he looking for? What is he looking for in our lives based on this passage that he is paying very close attention to? So much so that he will judge us according to it. When you hear these words in verse 9, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? For me, the first thing that comes to mind is all the bad things I do in my life. That's what God is looking at and pointing out and exposing. But notice something here. In verse 8 and 9, these verses are governed by this idea to rejoice. So what's the point? The amount of joy and delight in your life is just as important to God as the amount of sin and disobedience in your life. Maybe another way to put this is this. Here we have in the Bible something it teaches time and again, and I think we miss all too often, and it's simply this: that in the Bible, to rejoice is as much a command as to repent. Do you hear that? In the Bible, to rejoice is as much a command as to repent. One writer puts it like this: enjoyment is not only permitted, it is commanded. It's not only an opportunity, it's a divine imperative. You see, the judgment of verse 9 isn't talking about your failure to repent of what you do wrong. It's talking about your failure to rejoice in God and His goodness. In fact, if you are failing to rejoice, you're probably failing to repent too. That's the first thing we need to see here when it comes to rejoicing. We live before the gaze of God, and He is watching. What He's looking for is a heart of delight and joy in Him. But the second thing we need to see is, what does it mean to rejoice? Look again at verse 9. He says, "Let your heart cheer you in the days of your youth. Walk in the ways of your heart and the sight of your eyes." I think it would be easy to read verse 9 and think this. It would be easy to think to rejoice means I get to follow my own heart. I get to do what I want. It doesn't really matter what the consequences are. Here is the Bible's endorsement of what I want to do with my life. And if we're inclined to go down that road, I only need to point you to verse 10. Because what does verse 10 say? "Remove vexation from your heart and put away pain from your body." You see, here we have a very balanced statement about what it means to rejoice, and we need to listen to what does this actually mean. Simply put, what it means to rejoice is to live a life from the heart. It's life lived from the heart. Now, where else do we see this in the Bible? I would take you to Psalm 34, verse 7, where we read, "Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart." See, here's the point. Rejoicing is the fruit of relationship with God. That's the point here. Rejoicing is not following our own heart in the sense of we get to do whatever we want. The Bible's idea of rejoicing is that it's the fruit of relationship with God. But here, maybe you're asking yourself this question. I did. How are we to make sense of this in light of a passage like Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9, where it has very devastating things to say about your heart, like this: "The heart is deceitful and desperately sick." How are we to hold that together with what's being said here? You see, if you struggle to rejoice, to live from the heart with joy and delight, it isn't because of your circumstances. It's because you are delighting in someone or something more than God. That is the great deception and sickness of your heart and my heart. We have become deeply convinced that something other than God will truly satisfy us. I think this is the problem of the naive optimist. You look at life and you're convinced it's going to get better. And very quickly, the deception of our hearts look to those things to satisfy us, to fulfill us. But then there's the other side of the coin. You might be the person that says nothing can satisfy us ever, and we have to embrace it, no matter how hard that is to accept. And that's the hopeless pessimist. See, the preacher has done both of these, and he's discovered the only way to find joy is to lay hold of God, to get Him, to delight in Him, to rejoice in Him for who He is. But here's the question: how can we change? How can we get this new outlook on life? What does it look like to actually cultivate life, a life of rejoicing in the midst of life under the sun? That brings us to our third point here. The preacher calls us to, which is, we must remember our Creator. Look with me here, chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. Verse 1, "Remember also your Creator in the days of your youth." What does he mean by the word "remember" here? Here, remember means much more than just mere intellectual acknowledgement that God is there somehow, somewhere. The command to remember here is it's intended to have a powerful, transforming effect on every area of your life. You see, to remember God as your creator is to allow Him to shape your view of yourself, your view of other people, your view of your circumstances, and even your view of Him, of God Himself. To remember Him means He is the meaning maker in your life. And where you don't know, or you are unable to figure it out, to remember Him means you are trusting Him with what you don't know. So to remember Him in this passage is meant to have this powerful transforming effect. And it's ironic that throughout this entire book, the preacher has been doing the exact opposite of that. He's been trying to make sense out of life under the sun in his own strength, with his own finances, with his own intellect, only to discover that he can't. And here, in this passage, he is giving us the antidote to living independent, self-reliant lives, estranged from God. Let me try to show you this and illustrate this to you about what the preacher means by remembering God as your creator by reflecting on our identity. Think for a minute with me. For a long time, our culture has celebrated the opportunity to do and be anything you want. It has celebrated that life is a journey towards self-discovery, that our self-image and our identity become deeply bound up with our performance, our experiences, our successes and failures. In other words, self-discovery and self-creation are two sides of the same coin. That's what the preacher has been trying to do. But I want you to think for a minute. That's a very insecure way to live. You are trying to create your own identity. It's up to you. And if you stop and think about that long enough, it's very frightening. But think for a minute. When have you felt the most secure, the most content with yourself and who you are? I'm sure there are a number of ways to answer this, but my guess is at least one way is, in one place where you have felt secure, is when you're at home with family. Now, for sure, family is not always a fun place for some of us to be, but for many of us it is. And perhaps more than anywhere else, when you're home, you know you are loved and accepted. Listen how one writer reflects on this question. He says this: "In reflecting on my own life, I observe that those times when I have seemed most in touch with myself, when my self-identity has been most secure, have been those times when I was known by another and it was accepted by that person. My assumption now is that one's search for self ultimately is fruitless because it seeks to find that which can only be given by another. In short, we may seek self-identity and hope to find ourselves, but the hoped-for result never occurs through our own efforts. We seek ourselves, but are finally found." And listen to this. "One's identity is the gift of another's love." Now, I want you to take that same idea, that your identity is a gift of another's love, and apply it to this passage, this search for meaning and significance that the preacher has been on. We may seek to make sense of life under the sun in our own strength, but you can't. It is a gift to be received from God as your creator. You cannot find it in your own strength. If you want to experience joy in your life, you must receive it from God. That's what the preacher means when he tells us to remember our Creator. But then also, why, you might be asking, is there so much emphasis here in verse 1 on remembering God as our Creator? God is described in the Bible a number of ways, as a king, as a shepherd, as a father. Why Creator here? Especially when you're talking about a world that is broken, that is beyond our ability to fully comprehend and make sense of. I might like to have, I almost wish he had said, remember God is your father. I feel like I would like a hug and some comfort in light of this book. But here he says, remember God is your creator. And why is that important for living a life of joy and delight? That's the question I want us to answer here. And I think the answer is found in verses 1, second half of verse 1 through verse 7. And these verses are really an elaboration of verse 8, when the preacher of chapter 11, when he says, remember the days of darkness. These days that are described here in these verses are definitely dark. And it's somewhat obscured in our English Bibles, but these verses really are a poem. And they in fact, mirror in many ways the poem at the beginning of the book. Here we have a poem at the end of the book. And they can be, I think, somewhat difficult or a challenge to interpret. But I think if you were just to look at them and ask, what is the most simple, basic way of understanding what's happening here? I think we simply would be able to say, things are going from bad to worse. Things are not looking up in these verses. Let me give you a couple examples here. In verse 1, he says, I have no pleasure in these days. As we get older, there's weariness, there's fatigue. Verse 2 describes the darkening of the sun and the moon, which elsewhere in the Bible is metaphors to describe what the prophets call the day of the Lord. And this is in contrast to chapter 1, the poem I mentioned, where it describes the endless cycle of the sun rising, the moon setting, over and over. There's nothing new under the sun. Life is this endless rat race. And here at the end of the book, the preacher begins to talk about that cycle will come to an end. In verse 3 through 5, we have these images of catastrophe, of dashed hopes, social breakdown, fear, anxiety, and death. And even in verses 6 and 7, we see these everyday items that are used to live, to do work, that are shattered, only followed by the undoing of life itself. See, the point you need to grasp in these verses is they are describing the unraveling of creation. But the question is why? Why are things falling apart here? Earlier in the book, the preacher gives us his own answer. In chapter 7, verse 29, he says, God made man upright, but they have sought out many schemes. Have you ever thought of yourself as a schemer? Well, the Bible thinks that you're a schemer, that I am a schemer. You know what that means? To be a schemer is essentially this. Our strategy to figure out how to live life independently of God. That's what he means here. That's the problem. That's why creation and our lives are unraveling. We are schemers. And instead, we prefer to live independently from God. Instead of loving and serving and trusting Him as our Lord and Savior, we seek to be our own Lord and Savior. And it's at this point that we are in a position to answer the question, why does he here call us to remember God as our Creator? And it's simply this. We need a Creator God who can make a new creation. We need a God who can start over. And to remember God as our Creator is to believe that He is the only one who can do that, who can undo what we have done by scheming. See, in the beginning, God spoke creation into existence, and the preacher here is calling us to remember Him because only He has the power to do it again. Listen actually to Isaiah chapter 65, verse 17. For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former things shall not be remembered or come into mind. And earlier in Isaiah, In chapter 44, we begin to see how this idea of remembering God as our Creator is profoundly deep. Because in this passage, in chapter 44 of Isaiah, what the preacher is talking about here takes on monumental significance for us. And the preacher, as a teacher of Israel, of God's people, he would have known about this. Listen to what Isaiah says. He says, "The Lord, your Redeemer, who formed you from the womb. I am the Lord who made all things, who alone stretched out the heavens, who spread out the earth by myself." You see, here we, in the Old Testament, we have a picture of God as our Creator and our Redeemer. And you are being called to remember your Creator because you need Him to start over. And how has He done that? The good news of the gospel is that what we see here in the Old Testament is embodied in the flesh in the person of Jesus Christ. Listen to what the Apostle Paul says in talking about Jesus. "For by Him, Jesus, all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through Him and for Him." Jesus, the second person of the Trinity, in the flesh, as our Creator. But then just a few verses later, Colossians chapter 1, he says, "For in Him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through Him to reconcile to Himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of His cross." Jesus is our Redeemer. Now, you may be here tonight and you may be thinking that you need more money. It might be true. A better job. A better body. A spouse. Or maybe you might be thinking a better spouse. You might think you need more well-behaved children. I do. You can admit that. They probably need a more well-behaved father first. But maybe you think you need more time, more rest, or whatever you think you need. But just for a moment, consider with me, could it be that what you need more than anything else, any of those things, is a God who gets personally and painfully involved in the realities of your life in order to bring new life to you? Do you know that's what you need? And do you know that's what you have in Jesus? You see, we are all leaving a trail of death behind us. And your only hope in this life is that you believe in a God who makes dead people live. That you believe in a God who brings life out of death. And you see, the good news of the Christian faith is simply this: that God, through Jesus, is starting over. And you need Him to do that in your life. You see, the death and resurrection of Jesus is your guarantee that God is about the business of bringing new life into your life. And now perhaps maybe you are a forgetful person and you're horrible at rejoicing. And you need to hear me. There is good news for you in Jesus. Because the reality is you can't remember well enough or rejoice enough. But Jesus has for you in your place. And I want to finish with just two ways that He does this. The good news of the gospel is this: that even though we remember assignments, deadlines, song lyrics, in YouTube videos, and yet you forget God, He never forgets you. Jesus, the very last things He says to His disciples at the end of Matthew's gospel is simply this. He says, "Behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." If you want to remember God as your Creator and Redeemer, think about Jesus' promise to never forget you. And I promise you, you will begin to remember him. But secondly, the good news of the gospel is also that even though we rejoice in our performance, getting a job, getting a new toy, yet you don't rejoice in God and his goodness. He always rejoices in you. Listen to how the writer of Hebrews describes Jesus' joy. He says, "For the joy that was set before him," that's Jesus, "he endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God." Jesus' joy and delight run so deep that he was willing to suffer and die in your place in order to bring you back. In order to bring you home to a place where you are convinced that you are loved and accepted. To where you can be convinced that God smiles upon you until Jesus comes back and unto all eternity. If you want to rejoice in God and his goodness, think about Jesus' delight in you, and I promise you, you will begin to rejoice in him. So how can you become a joyful realist? Here's your answer. Remember your Creator, who's also your Redeemer, until you find yourself rejoicing in the beauty of God's grace and promises to make all things new. Let's pray. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are indeed a God who remembers us, and you rejoice in us. And we thank you that you have gotten personally and painfully involved in this life under the sun so that we could come home, that you could bring us home. Lord Jesus, thank you for giving up everything in order that we might have everything. And we ask that you, by the power of your Spirit, would take this passage and you would screw it down into our hearts, that you would make it lodge there, that we would remember our Creator and our Redeemer and find ourselves rejoicing in you from now and into all of eternity. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Now receive the benediction. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely. And may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it. Amen.